across Wisconsin from Civic Media. This is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Breitlow.
Well, that would be me. And it is Friday, and it is the first day of March 2024. Nice to have you along. All across the Civic Media Radio Network, and if you'd like to reach us during the hour at all, keep in mind there's a brand new phone number for many Civic Media shows. So special we put Civic in the name, 855-75-CIVIC, 855-75-CIVIC, or 855-752-4842. Send us a text. Let us know where you're listening from. Let us know what we've got for weather conditions out there, or put that on Facebook. We get a little note from Rob out in Tigerton every morning who says that right now in Tigerton it's clear and 30 degrees. Brittany Merlot is coming up in just a moment to tell us about the weekend forecast. We're also going to talk about National Women's History Month and why the delay in creating a national monument for the generations of women who fought and sacrificed at great cost for the right to vote. We'll have Mark Jacob coming in to talk about media coverage of the week's big stories, and Dan Schumacher kicks off our weekend talking a little bit of sports as well. But first, at 7:07, it's time to bring in meteorologist Brittany Merlot to talk about, well, let's say on this, as Rob pointed out to me, this first day of meteorological spring, which is all fine and good. But I also saw a note that out in California, in the Sierra Nevadas, they're going to get about 10 feet of snow this weekend. So, Brittany, I think we're in good shape.
Yes, there is just some crazy weather going on across the nation. And it's just been a wild winter overall, to be honest with you. So, it is the first day of meteorological spring. All the meteorologists have closed the books on winter. We're not going to be using that word anymore. I know that the what you guys call spring is still about 19 days away, but for us, it's over. So
not what we call spring. Greg, was it Galileo maybe, or somebody who figured out the whole tilt of the earth thing and all of that? So
hey, you know what, Pat?
I don't want to take all the credit.
Don't bring me into a fight with the meteorologist, okay? I'm not going to win this one for you.
Okay.
I'm going to be like, again. I'm like, the groundhog said so. He saw a shadow. Man.
You're right. Let's turn this back over to the scientist. Yes, welcome to spring, Brittany. Please continue.
So it is spring, and we're looking back at the records of February, and basically the entire state, a lot of these cities have made it for the warmest winter ever on record, ever. We're talking Milwaukee, about 2 degrees warmer than the record, so just shattering. That's the average highs right there. So just to take 2 degrees as an average bump is huge. It's outstanding. And it even happened into Wausau. It happened into Eau Claire. And now we're sitting here going on another roller coaster ride, kind of repeating what we saw earlier this week. So right now we're going to see temperatures soaring. We're already into the upper 20s to mid 30s out there this morning. Beautiful sunshine, clear skies. Winds are going to get feisty out of the south, gusting up to 30 miles per hour today. So that's going to soar us into the low 50s. Everybody's going to hit 50. We could even see some upper 50s as well, mostly towards the western parts of the state. And then tomorrow, the sunshine stays abundant. We climb into the 50s to low 60s. And then Sunday, 60s to near 70s. And then as we go into Sunday night and Monday, we're going to have a repeat of those thunderstorm chances, right? That storm hits us. There's going to be a little slice of warmth towards the Milwaukee area where you could see some stronger storms. But the entire state looks like it's going to see rain this time around as these temperatures get so warm. So that all holds off until Sunday night and early next week. We just have a nice, warm, sunny weekend ahead.
Very nice. And yours is going to be a little extended for folks going on Monday. Where's Brittany? She'll be back. Don't worry.
I'll be back.
Everybody deserves a little extra time. So by all means, you deserve it. Go enjoy it.
Where are you going?
And, she's fine. She's got stuff. She's got plans. And then you get to tease her for it for days afterwards, apparently, is the way it runs around here. But I'm not.
I'm sorry, but you started teasing yourself when you got back here.
I did, didn't I?
Yes, you did, Mr. Patrick Tyrannus Kreitlow.
I think you're you know what? You're getting in the way of my good vibes that I brought back from the island over here.
Darn it.
Here,
okay, hold on.
Okay, wait. There we go. Okay, see now? This is how you send Brittany off on a weekend.
Yes.
Enjoy it.
Actually, I have the perfect song for Brittany. Here we go.
Okay, here we go. Oh, God. No, winter's over. You heard Brittany. Winter's over.
I'm a layman. I got 19 more days. I got 19 more days.
Have fun in that winter season. I'll be in spring. Bye.
Thank you, Brittany. See you. All right. Temperatures around the state right now at 7 o'clock. It is 36 on Lake Wissota. It was 6 yesterday. Hayward's at 32. Park Falls, 30. Wausau, 30. Green Bay, 34 right now. La Crosse is at 35. Wisconsin Rapids, 30 degrees. Oshkosh, 31. Madison, 31. Waukesha is at 28 degrees over here. And Rob chimes in one more time from Tigerton. Greg, I don't know if he really wants us to debate this or not, that he had a dill pickle pizza last night at Blazers in Split Rock. Not being a pickle fan myself, I'm not sure what I think. Ooh, okay. So Greg's intrigued. So we got that going for us. So go ahead and send your weird pizza flavors into us as well. Text it at 855-75-CIVIC or, use the face page as well. We'd love to hear from you. Find out where you're at and what you're enjoying for meals these days. All right. And let's talk first about some extra attention that Wisconsin is going to get from some high-ranking women. First Lady Jill Biden is going to be in Milwaukee and Waukesha on Sunday afternoon. She's going to be she was in the Green Bay area on February 16th to talk about apprenticeships and economic growth. She was in Northeast Wisconsin in October to promote cancer screenings. Meanwhile, Vice President Kamala Harris is going to be coming to Wisconsin, to the Madison area, next Wednesday, just a few days later, also talking about apprenticeships, which I think is actually it's a good messaging opportunity, because for far too long, Democrats have been painted as like these ivory tower. Everybody's got a liberal arts degree. And as somebody who has a liberal arts degree, that's fine. I understand that. But it's more important for folks to understand whether a certain political party is widely representative of the population. In this case, blue collar workers. Do they have a home in the Democratic Party? Yes, they always have, despite the ivory tower attempts by Republicans who are busy protecting corporate interests and fighting for tax cuts for the very wealthy. So anytime you can get prominent Democrats to talk about the party's blue collar roots and actual record, that's a good thing. And so you have these two women coming to Wisconsin, the Vice President of the United States and the First Lady, to bring that message. I'm sure as well they're going to talk about National Women's History Month. And if you head over to upnorthnewswi.com right now, you'll see a story that I posted on there with the headline, "It's Women's History Month, so who's blocking Tammy Baldwin's bill to put a suffrage memorial on the National Mall?" Now, there are suffrage memorials that are out there, but this would be a big deal, to quote Joe Biden, to have a monument on the National Mall. I begin the article with an excerpt from one of the women who was arrested outside the White House in, I believe it was 1917, where women were staging a silent protest, that every day there would be women standing silently with signs about the right to vote. Not only were they either ignored or opposed and somewhat mistreated, sometimes they were arrested and put in deplorable conditions. And this is some of the reporting from suffragette Lucy Burns, who had been arrested one day outside the White House, taken to a prison farm rather than just the local jail. And she writes, "Our clothing was partly removed by force and we were examined. Dr. Gannon told me I must be fed because she was starting a hunger strike. I was stretched out on a bed, two doctors, a matron, and four prisoners present. I was held down by five people at arms, leg, and head. I refused to open my mouth, so Gannon pushed a tube up my left nostril. I turned and twisted my head all I could, but he managed to push it up. It hurt my nose and throat very much, made my nose bleed freely. The tube was drawn out, covered with blood. It left me very sick. Food being dumped directly into a stomach feels like a ball of lead. Very sore all night. And then I was brought to the hospital. This is for the crime of wanting to vote. That mistreatment by her and others turned out to be a turning point as the public found out more about what was happening. And eventually there would be a monument called the Turning Point Suffragist Memorial, where that prison farm once stood outside of Washington, D.C. in Fairfax County, Virginia. But plenty of other people would like to see a national monument to the women who fought for decades for the right to vote placed right on the National Mall. And Senator Tammy Baldwin, among others, a bipartisan group of lawmakers, introduced a bill saying that there should be a suffragist memorial on the National Mall. The obstacle right now is the National Park Service, which says that it considers the National Mall to be, quote, a substantially completed work of civic art. In other words, no new monuments or memorials unless an act of Congress passes an exception. And there has been one already in 2021 for the Global War on Terrorism Memorial. And clearly a lot of women believe, and their allies, that there should be a little piece of land on the National Mall dedicated for the suffragists who fought so hard. Tammy Baldwin put out a statement yesterday saying, "Our bipartisan legislation took a positive step forward in passing the House, and now I'm fighting to earn the support needed in the Senate to make sure we honor all those who fought for women's rights with this monument." She had said when the bill was introduced, "The National Mall is home to memorials for those who fought for our freedom, presidents who defined our country, and the seat of our government. And it is only fitting that it also houses the Women's Suffrage National Monument." Now, I don't know how this is invariably going to turn out. There need to be enough senators who are no longer persuaded by the National Park Service not to put any new monuments or memorials on there to make an exception in this case. And again, it wouldn't be the first exception made. So if you agree, you may want to contact Senator Baldwin's office or the National Park Service and find out how you can register your feeling that this memorial on the National Mall is overdue. Still to come, Mark Jacob is going to be along, Dan Schumacher, and much more on this Friday morning, March the 1st, wherever you're listening across Wisconsin on this beautiful morning. When you're here, you're up north on the Civic Media Radio Network.
For all the times that you rain on my parade, and all the clubs you get in using my name. You think you broke my heart, oh girl, for goodness sake. You think I'm crying on my own, well I ain't. And I didn't want to write a song, cause I didn't want anyone thinking I still care or don't. But
and right there is probably the most you'll ever hear of Justin Bieber on this fine radio program. But, thank you, Greg, for finding a little something for the birthday boy, for the Biebs.
He writes good songs.
Does it register with you at all that Justin Bieber turns 30? Is that some kind of a cultural touchstone for you, that this child prodigy who was busking at one point is now a 30-year-old man?
I mean, I knew he'd eventually get there. Hopefully, I guess. He had some hard times. I mean, I don't think about that stuff anymore. Like, yeah, he's 30. That's what's going to happen.
Father Time is undefeated.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, right. Exactly. Just, time's going to time, baby.
Yep. The temperatures this hour around the state, again, are in the 30s, a couple of upper 20s. Apparently a perfect day for a dip in an icy lake. If you missed it at the top of the 6 a.m. hour, Senate candidate Eric Hovde posting a weird, borderline creepy video of him, you know, taking a dip in an icy lake, as if that's what we all do. I can say confidently on Lake Wissota, I have never seen anybody wander out to a nearly frozen lake and just dip themselves for the sake of dipping themselves. He's like, what Californian would do that? I'm a Wisconsin boy. Like, I don't know. You've been out of the state quite a while. If that's your definition of proving your Wisconsinhood, But cut, I could be wrong.
Cut back 24 hours before that commercial, and he's saying, "You want me to do what?"
That's a good point. As somebody who has been in political commercials and where they talk about the concept and everything,
yeah,
there's sometimes you look back at something and go, maybe I should have said something.
Yeah.
But he didn't, and so we've got new things to talk about with Eric Hovde running for Senate. And it's not just that he's from California, but again, he has Wisconsin roots. But much like Tim Michaels, to go away and then come back, and you're spending so much time, on defense that you can't really, make the case that you want to make for the campaign. So feel free to see it online and let us know what you think. This next story is out of Bangladesh. And you're going to say, why? Because I want to make this one wider point. And we've talked a little bit already today about the difference in political classes between those who are looking out for workers versus those who are looking out for corporations and the very wealthy. It's a tragic story about a 6-story shopping mall that caught fire in the Bangladeshi capital. And the death toll so far is at least 46, but climbing. The country's prime minister said earlier today that this 6-story shopping mall had exactly 0 fire exits. Now, I don't know how many main entrances and exits there were, maybe 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever, but there were no emergency exits, which are there to make it easier for more people to get out in a hurry for something like this. And you're saying, well, yeah, Pat, I mean, we've gone through that already. I mean, for us, it was well over 100 years ago that you had the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire of 1911 in New York City. Again, a very tall building. They locked the exits. They barricaded the exits so that the women and girls who were making these dresses and shirts, couldn't take breaks. And as a result, 123 women and young girls and 23 men died in the fire or jumping out the windows to their death. And it was, again, another turning point in terms of safety for workers. And I bring all this up to say that, as we saw in Bangladesh, my point is that if people can and are allowed to take shortcuts, they will. Look at the way that they're still fighting something as basic as hiking the minimum wage, the bare minimum that you can legally pay somebody who's going to be working for you. This can and would happen again if we didn't keep this one basic thing in mind. Every time you hear regulations, 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 red tape, regulations, if every time you hear that, you simply ask yourself, is it red tape or is it a protection? So many regulations, like having a certain number of emergency exits, are protections for the workers, for customers, for natural resources. Every time that this comes up, ask yourself if there isn't somebody who wouldn't take advantage of having that protection removed. And let's be clear, there are wonderful, responsible business people in all walks of life, in all countries. But as we're seeing in this instance again, a decision made sometime in the past to take shortcuts led to the deaths of dozens of people. And frankly, many of those very good and responsible business owners, they too want these protections, these regulations, because it levels the playing field, because they're at a competitive disadvantage if they want to pay their workers better, but their competition across the street is allowed to take whatever shortcut possible to shortchange their workers. So I bring that up just to remind you again that were it not for what some people denigrate as red tape and regulations, do protect us, and that it could still happen here if we're allowed to go backwards. We've got a busy week scheduled already for next week here on Up North News Radio. We're going to be talking to a former U.S. attorney from Wisconsin on Monday. We're going to talk about judicial security. The political environment being what it is these days, there have been more threats to judges and attorneys than ever before. And the group Keep Our Republic, a bipartisan group that by and large is known for simply wanting to protect democracy and protect our elections, also wants to protect our judicial system as more people, whether they're wearing red trucker caps or not, decide that they don't want to abide by rules and norms and responsible conduct. So we'll talk about that on Monday. On Tuesday, we've got Hans Breitenmoser in, where we always talk about the rural economy. And there have been just so many announcements lately in the category of rural economic development. And look, if you're in the village of Edgar in Marathon County along Highway 29, if you hear that your old wastewater treatment plant is finally being replaced thanks to federal help so that you don't have to pony up the full cost up front at the local level, that's not something we're going to cover on a statewide show, just that by itself. But the fact that that's happening in Edgar and so many other places around Wisconsin should tell you something about the degree to which the Biden administration and the Evers administration are invested in the rural economy and actually looking out for its rural residents. So we're going to talk about that on Tuesday. On Wednesday, the hosts of Busted Pencils, our new 6 p.m. Well, it's not new, but it's new now as a nightly show, 6 p.m., all about education. Congressman Mark Pocan will be our guest on Wednesday morning as well. And then Thursday, Kristen Lierley's guest on her Women Win Wisconsin segment, Secretary of State Sarah Godlewski. Busy week ahead. Mark Jacob is coming up next, right after the Midwest Farm Report. You're up north. Sleeping on my own, 'cause if you like the way you look that I hear your heart beat to the beat of the drums. Oh, what a shame that you came here with someone. Happy birthday to Kesha. Kesha Siebert turns 37 years old today. Back on Up North News Radio for this Friday morning, March the 1st. Mark Jacob joins us now as well to talk about some of the media coverage of the big stories of the past week here. He also has the Media Misses feature that you can get, as well as his website, or the newsletter, rather, Stop the Presses. And that's at, stopthepresses.news, Mark, right?
That's it. Yeah, all very right. easy yeah. to remember. Stopthepresses.news. Free. It's right. free, too.
Yeah. Yes. See, we like that.
We like free.
That's a great price. Yeah. How are you otherwise?
I'm doing fantastic. Pretty good news week, I would have to say.
Yeah, there's
not good in like happy things happened. I mean, interesting news week.
Yes, very interesting. So let's see what we can hit there. But let's start with Media Misses, which you do with Stephen Beschloss. And I mean, I don't know how to put this. You're basically saying the math ain't mathing in terms of media coverage. That is 81% better than 68%, and of course we're talking about how the media covered the various results of the Michigan primary.
Right. In Michigan, you have two races on the Democratic and Republican sides, and the outcome really isn't in doubt as far as who's going to win. So Biden gets 81%. There's a 13% uncommitted. Minor candidates get a few. And, on the Republican side, Trump gets 68%, with Haley at around 27, I believe. And so, the news media, cover it in a way, instead of writing simply, the two expected winners won, which bores them and everyone else, they had to find some sort of angle. So, so the New York Times, for example, says that Biden, had a significant challenge, but at the same time, Trump coasted to victory. So apparently 68% is more than 81%, in the New York Times, and you have the Newsweek saying that Biden was embarrassed. It's desperation for a news story, for an angle, for a storyline, because there wasn't anyone that was very interesting. You know, but Pat, you know, they could always go back to covering actual issues. I mean, they could talk about healthcare or roads or things that people actually care about, but instead it's the horse race.
Yeah, again, the horse race thing where let's not forget that Trump is, a former president of the United States. So, yeah, he's being challenged. So is Joe Biden by Dean Phillips. And apparently Marianne Williamson, who actually topped Dean Phillips, now says she wants to get back in the race. And look, there was this symbolic vote. But again, all the focus is on November. And in November, you're not going to have 10 to 20% of Democratic voters saying, no, I'm not going to vote for Biden, because there is no box for uncommitted that time around. So let's be real about where this is actually going in November, not the snapshot in time from this week.
Right. And also those uncommitted voters, I believe, will almost all go back to Biden, in the fall. Biden won Michigan by 150,000 votes last time. I mean, to pretend that they're, I don't know. To me, I just feel like the media sometimes is just trying to ratchet up the drama, even when it's not there.
Yes, they are. And it's unfortunate, because there are real issues to cover. And that takes us to the U.S. Supreme Court agreeing to take up Donald Trump's case or claim that he should have absolute immunity as a president. And, a court of appeals already smacked that down and made very clear that there was not a legal leg to stand on at any given point. And I've said, to try to condense this, you could make the case the Supreme Court is trying to do its due diligence and say, well, we think there should be a U.S. Supreme Court, stamp on this.
Right.
But given that they've decided far less significant cases in far shorter windows, this sure looks like a political action to help Trump drag this process out and delay.
Yeah, I mean, Jack Smith asked the Supreme Court to handle this in December. I mean, so they screw around, they let the appellate court do its thing, and then they're going to take up the case again. You would think that the Supreme Court, they read the newspapers, they know what's happening. They're not deciding cases, in a vacuum. They should believe that Trump ought to go on trial before the election. Isn't that what's best for the American people? I mean, we're deciding on who's going to be president of the United States. And as Greg Sargent says in a piece today, people don't seem to realize that if the trial gets pushed beyond that, Trump will be able to negate it. He'll be able to order his Justice Department to drop the charges. And so it's not a matter of whether we have the trial before the election or after the election. It may be a matter of whether we have the trial at all if we don't have it before the election.
That's exactly right. And look, there is another point being made out there that says, you should not be waiting for the courts to save us. Only the voters can save us. And I feel like that's missing the mark, because it does always come down to the voters, but that certainly doesn't mean that there isn't a role for the courts. And if an accused criminal is going to be on the ballot, you're not doing any favors by delaying justice and saying it should just be up to the voters. Let's stop with the thought that that justice has no role, even if there is an election going on right now.
No, and let's focus for a second here on how absurd the whole argument of immunity is. What that means is if the Supreme Court decided that president had complete immunity, well, then Joe Biden could go arrest them the next day. He could arrest the entire Supreme Court as well as the Trump and throw him in prison because he's got immunity. It's a terrible legal argument, yet it has successfully for Trump delayed justice, delay, and that's all he wants.
Oh, sorry, had my little mute button pushed there. Yeah, that's been the way that Trump, and we knew this from when they were first filed, when all these cases were first filed. It was put out there that Donald Trump already has an extensive court record, primarily in business dealings, of course, but that delaying things and trying to wear down the people suing him. I mean, he knows how to work the system. And it's so strange for me that there still seem to be people in the system or people reporting on the system who don't seem to get that and include that in their coverage.
Right. I mean, it's all just throw as much crap against the wall as you can and try to, I mean, I think I really respect our system of justice, and I think people need the ability to appeal and to make their argument. But Pat, I don't know if in American history there's ever been a case where somebody has abused the system of justice so terribly to in effect negate justice.
Well, that's what it is. I mean, again, it's the old saying, you know, justice delayed is justice denied. And that seems to be exactly what he's seeking. Along those lines, again, he is accused of tampering with an election and trying to overthrow the results. And there is clear evidence that the wife of a sitting Supreme Court justice was among those advocating for the overthrow of American election results. How is there not something being said by Chief Justice John Roberts to say, Clarence, Thomas, why don't you set this one out?
Yeah, really. I mean, well, you can't force it. That's the thing. There's nothing in the law that would allow Roberts to force Thomas to sit this one out. Clearly, he should if he was an ethical person. But he's clearly not an ethical person. He's like taking money and trips and a fancy RV and all this other stuff. I mean, he's just a corrupt human being, and his wife is an insurrectionist. It's. I can't believe we're at this stage. And I was thinking yesterday of how psychologically torturous it must be for Elena Kagan and Sonia Sotomayor and Justice Jackson, the newest one, and to see they got to be watching this happen. And they've got to and be helpless to stop it because they're in the minority 6-3. My belief is that Alito and Thomas have just decided that they are on the Republican side. They're partisan actors, and they're going to do everything they can to stall it. And they may have insisted that the Supreme Court hear it because they're not interested in justice. I mean, Alito and Thomas, they're just in bed with Trump, in my
opinion. And the double standard is real. And what I mean by that is if any of those three liberal justices or, Ruth Bader Ginsburg before had even a fraction of what Clarence Thomas and Samuel Alito and the others were given, I honestly believe the coverage would be almost around the clock as far as, when is Justice so-and-so going to give this back or recuse themselves? And again, there's such an expectation of flaunting the rules on the other side that to too many people, it's like, well, I guess that's not a story. It really is and ought to be a story.
It's not a story because it happens all the time, because Republican corruption is considered not a story because it's just routine.
Well, and that gets us to the investigation, quote unquote, into Hunter Biden. Right. And a lot of folks are focusing on how Hunter Biden came in to testify. And by the way, as predicted, because it was behind closed doors, Republicans are already spinning misinformation on what happened inside that room. But the larger issue, and I tried to look at the news as little as possible last week. I'm lying on that beach. I'm trying to relax. But I am watching how it becomes known that the Republicans' like star witness is now sitting in a jail cell accused of being essentially a Russian agent. So the entire Biden impeachment investigation is built on disinformation from Russia. They're interfering. Republicans in Congress are being stooges. Why isn't I almost started yelling on the beach, like, how is this not a story that you were going on nonstop about? This is the big deal.
Right. Why isn't it? Why can't the news media turn it on Comer and that whole bunch? And I mean, because when you do an investigation that's baloney, as this is, and it's proven that, well, then it ought to be on you. It shouldn't be, well, all right, well, let's move on to the next story. It should be, the next story should be, why is this investigation taking place at all? And this is a longstanding pattern for the Republicans under Trump, that they want investigations because that gins up the news cycle. It gives Fox News something to talk about endlessly. But they know they don't have the evidence, and they know it won't ever come to anything. But Pat, they don't care if it comes to anything. I always remember that, when Trump had that phone call where he was trying to pressure Zelensky to start an investigation in Ukraine, he knew the investigation wouldn't come to anything. He didn't want a result that would do anything. He wanted an investigation announced. I mean, it was clear that...
Which is what he said after the investigation as well to law enforcement, of just say that there are irregularities that you're looking into.
I don't think he wanted anyone to investigate anything. He wanted an announcement. That's what he wanted, so that they could talk about it endlessly and dirty up Biden.
So it's
this perversion of what should be a strong part of democracy, which is investigating wrongdoing.
And it's not happening because you fall again for the both sides-ism. So like yesterday, you had dueling visits, both Biden and Trump, going to the border, talking about the issue. But again, by just framing it as both these men went to the border, and if you leave out the part about Republicans tanking, you know, a bipartisan bill that they had demanded, your coverage is so guilty of both sides-ism, and it's exactly what we talk about week after week.
Right. And it was good to see, to me, some effective messaging from the Democrats on this issue, because they've just been getting beat up on this issue for, you know, years. But to see Biden say, okay, you want to do a deal? I'll do a deal with you, Trump. Work with me. And he knows Trump won't work with him. And so it's messaging. It's not that he thinks he's going to get a deal, but he's also like pushing this compromise. I mean, Pat, that border bill that almost was going to get somewhere until Trump ordered Mike Johnson to tank it, that was going to be a tough thing for the Democrats. I mean, it was a compromise. It wasn't what the Democrats wanted. It was a compromise they wanted to do to actually take action on what's a real problem. I agree it's a real problem, and nobody's trying to deny that. But it's a problem. The Republicans want the problem. They don't want the solution. That's the thing. They want the issue. They don't want to fix it.
No, they don't, because that would, again, involve looking for solutions. And if Democrats are going to get even a scintilla of credit, then they don't want to do it. Find what Mark is working on over at stopthepresses.news and to look for media misses. And I'm sorry, we ran out of time to talk about Mitch McConnell and Tommy Tuberville. I think, call it predictable. I think you already know what would happen.
I think you know where I stand on Mitch McConnell.
Thank you, Mark. Have a good weekend.
Go ahead.
All right, Dan Schumacher, when we come back, you're up north. This guy has kind of a little.
You know what, Greg did a nice pick there. That's true. It's kind of like that.
Yeah, I heard you guys talking about it, and I was like, "Fire on the Mountain" has a taste.
A taste. Yep.
I like it. I like it very much.
I'll tell you both. It was last weekend. Out of the blue, there was a Grateful Dead cover band called Another One. That played at the historic Ironwood, Michigan Theater. And I drove over the 40 minutes with a couple of their guys to check the band out. And they played Fire on the Mountain. It was a fun time. Unbelievable theater. Beautiful theater that was restored downtown Ironwood. It was just a great crowd and a good time on a Saturday. Late, last-minute plans, and it was a good time. And
great.
Still home nice and early and safe.
All right. Before we get into all the normal Wisconsin-based sports, we've got a comment on Facebook. Tony chiming in says, I got to know from the Bears fan, is it Fields or Caleb Williams next year?
I think it's going to be Caleb. I really do. I think that I think Fields is going to be on his way to Atlanta. That's my prediction.
All right.
And they, based on how many draft picks Atlanta has, they have something to give up. I don't want to, personally, as a Bear fan, I would like to keep Fields and get as many picks as I possibly can by trading the pick away, going down one slot and gathering a bunch of more that would lead into next year's draft as well. But, you know, I'm not in that seat right now, but Mr. Poles is.
How far away are we from the draft now? It's an April thing, right?
It's in April 11th.
Yeah. All right. So we can spend more time on that coming up in a bit, but you know, we gotta say it's, you know, spring is around the corner. It certainly has felt like spring. I'm sure some of your spring sports up there at Northland starting to get warmed up and ready to
go. You know, ironically, the unbelievable contrast. So last year, they didn't have a home baseball game or home softball game. We were practicing. We've been practicing out on the grass field for the last 2 weeks.
Hey, wow.
So it's quite the difference of a winter from last year to this year. And that's for everyone, too. So, you know, we're not traveling to try to get games in right now, but we're starting spring break today, as a lot of schools are. So they will be heading south to get competitions in, and it won't matter if it's us or the Badgers, which they don't have, they got softball, but you know, any school, they're all going south to be able to get games in.
Okay. You know, when you think about what has been, you know, one of the bigger stories in sports this week, you're coming out of the NBA All-Star break. The Bucks had gone 3-7 under Doc Rivers, and the talk was, okay, I guess he does not know how to fix the defense. And then other people were saying, to borrow a phrase from Aaron Rodgers, R-E-L-A-X.
Yeah, and right.
I guess that's what we should have done. I don't know how much of it was Doc. I don't know how much of it was just getting that break. But the Bucks have definitely figured out how to do defense again after beating Charlotte again last night, 111-99.
Yeah, I tell you, I didn't think it was a good move when they made the move to bring in Doc Rivers, but you can't argue against the guy's history, you know, his knowledge of the game. You got to believe he was going to bring something to the table to help the defensive side. So maybe that's finally – the team's finally getting it, and they're buying into it, and it allows them to play a lot better these last couple of games.
So the Bucks are in Chicago to play the Bulls tonight. These Friday night games are always late. The broadcast doesn't start till 8:30 on Oshkosh Air Support, News from the Center and Richland Center, Lake Erin Amory, WRJN in Racine, 98Q Country in Park Falls, and locally grown radio in Wisconsin Rapids to hear the Bucks and Bulls. And I don't know, the Bulls, are they kind of an afterthought now, or what kind of a season are they been having?
I don't know what to make of them. Don't know what to make of them. I really don't. But to take a step back, we talked about this. Somebody asked me about Caleb Williams. Hey, the draft next year is in Green Bay, isn't it?
Yes, next year.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think we should be moving the radio show to the draft.
Hey, we have a studio there. I'm not above doing that. Tony chimes in, as an Ohio State fan, I'm biased toward Fields. I think he has a lot of potential. So
I do too. I just think he needs some kind of quarterback whisperer just to help him a little bit. And I mean, he has all the tools. There isn't a tool that he does that. How does Caleb Williams have more tools than Justin Fields? I can't get anybody to point out exactly what that is. Mm-hmm. Other than the fact is that I love the idea of Caleb Williams' father is doing all the negotiation, and Caleb doesn't believe in agents, but they still want a piece of the team, whatever team they go to. And there's my hindrance on why I don't think if he's going to demand he wants a piece of the team, there's no way the Chicago Bears will agree to that. They've never agreed with
piece of the family. Team. What does that mean?
He wants to be a shareholder. What's his
yes, name? He does. His dad has come out publicly. He said it he's down at the combine right now. He's not doing any of the physical work, but he's meeting with teams, but they're pushing to have a piece of the team, you know, but I'm sitting there going, it's not even Tom Brady. And he's got a little piece of the team with Tampa when he signed with them. But you know, there's no way the McCaskey family gives up ownership to an unknown.
Are the McCaskey families the sole owners? Do they own it 100%?
Yes. There's one silent partner that was George Halas's family silent partner for years, but the McCaskeys own 67% of the team.
Gotcha.
We need to cue up the audio from the commercial with the old lady going, that's not how this works. That's not how any of this works when it comes to NFL ownership, you know?
I want a piece of the team. All right, well, have a good day. That was fun meeting
you.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yep, that was a short conversation. The Marquette men's basketball team, ranked 5th in the country, plays Creighton in Omaha on Saturday. So Marquette certainly seems to be for real this year.
You do, but isn't their best player about to be ruled ineligible?
I don't know.
Academically ineligible, not athletically, but academically. Okay. I was reading that their best player is their shooting guard. He wound up getting hurt the other night. His ribs took a shot to the ribs, but I was on the impression they were debating to allow him to move on Marquette to deem him eligible based on his grades.
Oh, okay. Well, that would be big.
So that would be hard. That would be a difficult one for Marquette to swallow coming into this late in the season.
And the Badger men's basketball team returns home to play 13th-ranked Illinois tomorrow. You can catch the game on locally grown radio in Wisconsin Rapids, News from the Center, Lake Erin Amory, WRJN in Racine. I'll have all that going on. So,
well, Coach Gard's, he's on the hot seat, in my opinion, though.
Yeah.
Coach Gard is on. And his brother just won the WIAC. His brother down at UW-Platteville is the coach down there, and they just won the WIAC, and they're the number one seed in the region here. Platteville. So one brother's doing good, the other one's struggling.
I guess. All right. And then finally, Badger men's hockey. They host Michigan State for the Big Ten title. You can catch the game tonight, 7:30 on WFHR in Wisconsin Rapids. Dan Schumacher, thank you so much. Have
Gentlemen,
a great start
a good
to
weekend.
The weekend. All right. Greg, thank you. Have fun at the Laughing Tap tonight.
Thank you, sir. Will do.
All right. We'll see you all Monday morning. Up North News is the Wisconsin digital outlet for Courier, a pro-democracy news network building a more informed, engaged, and representative America. You can follow us on social media. Sign up for our newsletter at upnorthnewswi.com. Thanks for joining us up north on this Friday. See you Monday.